Good morning, everybody. We're going to go ahead and get started. If you do have any questions or any comments during the webinar, everybody is muted. Please write them in the question section. I'll be monitoring that the questions the entire time. You do have handouts available on the control panel. They're all set and ready for you if you need to look over them. And I guess that we are being recorded. Now handing it over to Susan Osborne.
So good morning, everyone. Happy Wednesday. We're glad to have you with us this week. We're a week early because y'all have some things planned for our regular fourth Wednesday of the month. So we're glad to have you with us today. We have a pretty hefty agenda. So we're going to start with child support. We're going to then move into emergency management, a hot topic for everybody right now as we are in our first month of hurricane season. We're going to hear from Aging and Adult Services, an update from Child Welfare, and maybe Medicaid transformation, but we're not sure. So we may get out early. So just remember to type your questions in. We'll address them at the end of each presentation. So we're ready to get started, and I'll turn things over to Carla West, our child support director, so she can talk some about the new requirements for criminal background and that policy, as well as an update on incentive payments, which I am sure everyone will want to hear, Carla.
I'm sure they will. Thank you, Susan, and good morning, everybody. Happy Wednesday. As you all know, we've been discussing for well over a year now about the IRS requirements that that will require all members of your teams who have access to federal tax information to comply with a federal and local background check, fingerprinting, and also to verify that they are eligible to work. So we have been working very hard on our policy and policy guidance for the counties. Up until this point, we've concentrated on gathering the names from the counties of who will be actually submitting the information to conduct the background checks. We've developed and finished the website that your team members who are identified to submit those background checks will use. And we have finalized the policy that the state will be following at a state level. Our next steps are to communicate with you so that you can also adapt your policies or adopt a policy. Also get your rollout schedule so you'll know when your county sets up for sending your staff to get their fingerprinting done. And also to get your team members who are going to be submitting the names for the background checks trained to do that. So the state of North Carolina is going to be starting rollout for our state employees next week to test the process and make sure that we've got it good guidance for you. We've also developed a draft policy for the counties. And what we've done is we've taken the state of North Carolina's policy and our attorney general right now is reviewing it for your purposes so that you can adapt that. And Andy, if you wouldn't mind going to the next slide. So when I say that, obviously we are aware that counties may have already policies in place for background checks, or maybe have some specific rules at a county level that you have to follow. So the policy that we are going to be giving you is a guideline that you could either adopt as a whole for your county or adapt to fit your purposes. If you were to choose to adapt it, your policy has to include certain elements in order to be in compliance with the IRS background checks that are within the publication 1075. The first thing that your policy would have to include is that all of your employees that have access to federal tax information just has to clearly state that they're subject to local and federal background checks, to the Federal Bureau of Investigation fingerprinting, and the citizenship requirement, which is the I-9 form that you're probably already completing now. It also will have to include the fact that before you can give access to any of your employees to federal tax information, the check has to be completed, that it comes back favorable. And the word suitability background check comes directly from actually the state of North Carolina general statutes that talk about background checks, and it'll be defined in the policy that you get. But generally speaking, it means it came back positive. And then the last thing that your policy has to include is that it applies to all of your current employees that have access to FTI and then any future employees that you are going to hire. And it has to be completed every 10 years that it's done. So we've talked a lot about how this is going to get paid. And as a reminder, the fee for the Federal Bureau of Investigation check that's completed through the State Bureau of Investigation is $38 per person. When that fee comes through, it's going to be actually billed to the state, and the state is going to pay 100% of that cost. We're going to go ahead and draw down the 66% federal financial participation match, and then your 34% share will be a line item deduction on your monthly EFT reconciliation. That's a little bit of a change from what we had said before. The reason why that's a change is we sat down with your LBLs and the controller's office to come up with the best process to make it smooth and easy. So instead of you paying 100%, putting on your 1571 and drawing down 66%, we've taken out that layer and we're going to do it this way instead. You won't be billed until you actually have your employees' checks done. So we will receive a bill every month that says these are the employees that the background checks were completed. Here's the charge for those employees and what county they're assigned to. So we'll know exactly who has been checked and what county that fee should be assigned to. Before I open it up to questions, I also just want to add, I've gotten some questions about the multi-factor authentication fee. As you know, that fee is $1.50 per month per user, and all of the counties have now completed their rollout for the multi-factor authentication. We still, however, as a state, have not received a bill for the multi-factor authentication, so that's why you have not seen that on your EFT either. But the same thing would occur with that fee as with the background fees. Your 34% share will be a line item deduction on their monthly EFT reconciliation. So before I move on to talk about incentive settlement awards, I'll just open it up for any questions. Andy, are there any?
Not so far.
Okay. I'll pause for 2 seconds for somebody furiously typing. And if not, we'll move on to the second topic.
Oh. Any idea when MFA will be turned back on?
So they are working on that. For those of you who don't know, on Monday there was a glitch and the MFA stopped working, and so we had to turn it off as they're correcting that glitch. My report that I got yesterday said that they are identifying the issue, and so hopefully it'll be turned back on by the end of the week. Great question, though. Okay, so typically at this time of the year, you would all be receiving a letter letting you know what your settlement for your incentive funds would be for the federal fiscal year that ended 2 years prior. As you know, that we receive incentive dollars based on our performance on the 5 incentive measures that the Federal Office of Child Support Enforcement has set up, and it's compared to all the other states and U.S. territories on a federal fiscal year, and then also based on the results of the federal data reliability audit that's completed on every state and U.S. territory. the federal government advances us incentive fees based on a formula that that is based on the performance the prior year. But until the federal financial, until the federal data reliability audit is completed, we do not know what our actual incentive dollars would end up being for federal fiscal year 2017. So normally we'd be getting a letter. Last year, you might remember we had a delay in the audit that caused us to do a partial settlement in June and then do a final settlement when we got our final results of what our incentive dollars would be. The difference between last year and this year is last year our audit had been completed and we knew that at least as of this date we had passed that audit. This year our data reliability audit started actually last week. So it is very delayed and we have no way of knowing whether or not we are going to pass, let alone what the rest of the states were being done. So let's go to the next slide. I think I covered all of that slides there as I was just talking. I apologize for that. So the decision was made to delay paying out any of the incentive settlement dollars until after the data reliability audit was completed and we knew how much we would be eligible for in incentive dollars. So I'm going to open it up and just see if there are any questions about that process and any questions remaining about the background and fingerprinting checks. Well, thanks for making it easy on me. I hope you all have an amazing day, and I will, that's my contact information. If you have any questions following this, please feel free to email me or call me, and I'll turn it back over to Susan.
Okay, great. Thanks, Carla. So we will move right along, a tad bit ahead of schedule, and we're going to talk with Paris and Michael, Paris Penny and Michael Beckett, about emergency management update as we begin our hurricane season.
Thank you. It's hard for many of us to imagine that it is already June when it seems like Hurricane Florence just happened. It's very, many of us are still feeling the impacts of that. We really want to thank the counties and all the local community agencies for all their work and partnerships during Hurricane Florence. This hurricane gave us an opportunity through an after-action review for the department to reflect on our response and recovery efforts and to both highlight successes as well as identify opportunities to make our response that much better during the next storm should we have another event. Yes, knock on wood. We're continuing to look at our internal structure so we understand how divisions and agencies kind of interact with each other and plan around that in the event. And that includes looking at our human service side, emergency service side, better coordination and integration with those. Out of this after action review, we realized the need to kind of develop and carve out some potential new roles. Those are going to be, so we have Michael Beckett, who's also in the room.
Good morning, everybody.
And Michael is the Secretary's designee for emergency management. So it's very important for emergency management, preparedness, mitigation, response, and recovery. Secretary's designee for all of those. Again, I'm Paris Penny, and I'm going to be your human services cert lead for the department. We'll cover most of your human services side of the house. And then many of you have worked with Carlotta Dixon over the years. We'll continue to work with Carlotta. She's our DSS cert lead. So when there is an activation, you'll hear from Carlotta and our other DSS cert members about shelters and reaching out to you. We do want to say that in the future, you will be receiving information from us about North Carolina emergency management with drills and exercises. I think that's going to be a great opportunity for us to practice some of the things we want to implement during a practice drill as opposed to a real event. That way we can refine it and be better prepared and get your feedback before a real event. All that's to say, you're not going to see a whole lot of changes in the people contacting you initially, but we will have more staff support at the State Emergency Operations Center to support you and the other efforts going on. If there's any questions about Will Clarity, yes.
Just skipped
one. Whoop. So next, we wanted to talk a little bit about disaster preparedness and areas for consideration. There's just general preparedness, and this is where, you know, as well as counties and ourselves, have been looking at updating our resource books, making sure all of our contacts are current. And I know Michael sent out a disaster preparedness, your county director letter on May 15th. It provides a lot of information for you and your families, as well as areas for consideration that we'll talk about a little bit, and training. So there's also, within that letter, access to shelter management training through the American Red Cross. It would be really important during this blue sky period to take an opportunity to do.
I like that.
I can't take credit for it, but it's very common among those in the emergency management field. So I do want to say, while we remain hopeful there will be very few events this season, it is predicted to be slightly less active, with 14 named storms, 7 are which forecasted to become hurricanes. However, as you know, we've already had one named tropical storm. That was in May. And emergency management has already been activated this year for statewide flooding. That happened a couple weeks ago, and a few counties opened shelters as a result of that. So again, it's best for us to be prepared and use this blue sky time to review our emergency preparedness plans, our continuity of operation plans, our businesses and service operations. And again, on the slide are just areas to be thoughtful about. There's going to be an update. So counties will be seeing or getting a plan before the end of June or on the 1st of July, with information about child welfare, DSNAP, aging and adult services. That's going to be very helpful in your planning, and as well as giving us some feedback for our planning.
So, Paris, if I can jump in really quickly.
Absolutely.
And historically, what the department has issued sometime in mid-July over the past couple of years is an updated sort of DSS sort of disaster plan. And we recognize that that disaster level information that was contained in there was not necessarily the most helpful. And so we're actually sort of transforming the document into things that are going to, that will be helpful to you. It will include some information about sort of shelter management, selection, and some basic things from the Red Cross and training, but it will also cover all of the areas that that Paris has mentioned. There's a section on sort of preparation and response for APS and guardianship. These state's new child welfare disaster plan is included. You may recall last year, the child welfare disaster plan came as a shock. It came a few days right before the hurricane, and it was not what we needed it to be. The new child welfare disaster plan is at a high level, has been presented as part of our child and family services plan. And I am continuing to work with a small group of directors to review how do we take that and make it sort of manageable and consumable for counties. And so next week, we actually have a meeting with a small group of directors who have definitely been very helpful and instrumental in some of the language that has been provided around sort of disaster management documentation. We just reviewed the DSNAP plan. That will also be part of the information, and then there will be a component in there about shelters, from opening shelters to closing shelters, including staffing from counties to the multi-agency shelter teams that help close out shelters and what supports may be needed locally. And so we want it to be a comprehensive, usable document that will actually guide your planting and planning and intervention during a disaster period. Thanks.
So probably one of the big topics is around shelters. And I really wanted to talk about the importance of shelter count. So the American Red Cross is the designated entity to input the shelter count into the national shelter system. This count is entered no later than 11 p.m. every night the shelter is open. The American Red Cross reaches out to shelter managers to obtain the number of persons registered to sleep in the shelter. It is really imperative to provide this count because funding is based on this information, as well as the length of the federal declarations. So the number of days, the amount of funding, a lot of this is based on how many shelters are open, how long the shelters are open, what is our population. So we really wanted to stress the importance of the shelter count. Something new, I think that you'll be seeing a lot more this year within shelters are FAST teams. During Hurricane Florence, emergency management and the department realized the need to work more efficiently across our agencies to use our state resources during the disaster, requiring emergency shelters for persons with functional needs in collaboration with counties and the American Red Cross. One area of improvement we've done is more robust, functional, and trained state emergency response teams. Many of you have heard about the Functional Assessment Support Team. This is FAST. We love our acronym. Not NCFAST, but FAST, Functional Assessment Support Team. So this will help access people or assess people with access and functional needs and assist them by getting what they need to stay in the shelter. We are going to be providing content and the information manual Michael talked about around FAST and MAST, the multi-agency shelter transition team. Because the MAST team is when there's a federal declaration, it involves FEMA, some of the other federal partners like HUD, emergency management, as well as the department is involved in DSS. Our vocational rehabilitation was involved this time, aging and adult services, AAAs, a lot of community agencies support the MAST team. Another area we wanted to kind of bring up and talk about is there is a state shelter task force from North Carolina Emergency Management. Also true for Hurricane Florence, this is the first time that state supported shelters were opened. So therefore there's a state task force to address whether this will be something continued in the future, as well as some work groups within that to support county, American Red Cross, or perhaps state shelters to better address public health nursing, mental health, that was a big issue, the mental health resources within the shelters, host shelter, Hearst County shelter work plan, and some of the collaboration we mentioned earlier in emergency services and human services, is Narcan was a big issue that came up and making sure this was available in shelters. We're working with emergency services and our partners at Public Health to see how we can provide this, what availability is there within the county.
One of the things Paris mentioned is about mental health in the shelters. And during Hurricane Florence, we recognized especially in our work with some of the counties, that a best practice would be to have mental health in shelters when they open. And so one of the things that Paris is elevating is that it's not just this part of the department or public health. There's a lead for emergency management and mental health, public health, OEMS, as well as on the human services side. And we are in regular conversation about how we will, at the state level, be supporting sort of shelter operations, including what's high on the priority list is the is integrating mental health into shelters. I just want to elevate that as a big issue. And then I'm actually going to take the sex offender piece. There have been a couple of questions coming from, a number of counties about what to do about sex offenders in shelters. And it's a hard question. And I'll echo what I've heard over and over and over from emergency management, that shelter operations are, they start local, they end local. And for the state-operated shelters that are being considered, those start state, those end state, and it's the same question that is on the table potentially for the potential of state-operated shelters. And at this point, I had actually sort of consulted with the Office of General Counsel here at the department, and I've consulted with the Office of the Attorney General. And the guidance that I've been given is to direct counties to take that question to the county attorney. Because the challenges that are bubbling up are really about the interface between local entities, between what, how the sheriff or local police will respond to a sex offender in a shelter, if a sort of the belief, and that may conflict with the beliefs of the director of social services, who sees shelter as a life-saving intervention in the time of an emergency. And so sort of going back to your county attorney to getting some guidance on how to interface with local law enforcement, and maybe even bringing in some folks from probation and parole at the state level to have that conversation, because there's different entities that have sort of a stake in the game around sex offenders, the safety of children. You know, I think from one county, you know, their law enforcement said, well, they can't, like, sex offender can't be close to a school. And then the question was, well, is a school really a school when it's serving as a shelter? And that really goes back to sort of local operations. And so anything that we can do to support the conversation with, but at this point, you know, we're going to continue to push on this, especially as we sort of start moving down the pathway of state coordinated regional shelters. In the future, we may have a different, more targeted response, but at this point, the direction is for counties to have that conversation locally with your county attorney.
And so I'm going to put my old county hat on for a minute and say that one of the issues, the last shelter we had is, and in our shelter planning, is that the Red Cross doesn't allow any screening. So that's another piece in that puzzle at the local level that maybe could be elevated to the state conversation. Because even if your county attorney says, yeah, it's okay to have them, to screen them, and your sheriff says to screen them, but if the Red Cross is there and they are managing the shelter, they won't allow for screening.
Sure. Thank you. I have one question that came in, Paris, about shelter counts. For clarification, the shelter count should come from EOC instead of shelter managers, correct?
No, the American Red Cross will reach out to the shelter managers and ask for that count by 11 p.m. each night. It's really important that the information is put correctly in the shelter board and web EOC so that there is a 24-hour contact number and name for the shelter manager. That's critical, so that contact information is there.
Very important that those shelter managers know that they can release that information to the American Red Cross.
Yes, and why they're releasing the information, because it's tied to funding and the federal declaration.
And I think it's important that the Red Cross reaches out on behalf of North Carolina Emergency Management to every shelter, regardless of who's operating the shelter, that they're making that call on behalf of North Carolina Emergency Management. And so while there are some, and so what we noticed during Hurricane Florence is that there were some counties who felt like if it was a county operated shelter, the Red Cross didn't have any business in knowing what was going on in that shelter. The issue is that the number of people in the shelter becomes the official count. And when we don't have an accurate count, it actually adversely impacts our federal funding from FEMA and sort of the length of the disaster period. And so it is helpful to recognize that emergency management is, Red Cross is working on behalf of North Carolina Emergency Management, and they sit right next to DSS in, next to the DSS CERT desk in the Emergency Operations Center. So if there's any question about that, a county shelter manager could always say, hey, can we talk to the DSS person? I'm going to make sure, I want to get some clarity. But Red Cross gets the official shelter count.
Another comment. There's a question on the intake form that asks you if you're required to register to any authority. The person says, is that correct? I'm not sure if there's a question on the intake form that asks if you're required to register to any authority. A follow-up on the count. Why can't American Red Cross get the numbers from what's reported to the EOC?
That would be great. It would be great if we didn't have to reach out to every shelter. The challenge is that the shelter board is not updated routinely by counties.
Right.
And I'm not going to notice, I said by counties. I'm not saying by departments of social services. Counties are not updating that information. And if there was confidence that between 10 p.m. and 11 p.m. that it was sort of updated and accurate, then there wouldn't be a need for a call. But what we notice is that the shelter board's not getting updated, which necessitates a call. And the reason that people are calling is because of the importance of the number of people in shelters to get the most accurate information one time a day. And that is the number that is used around the state and is actually reported to the governor, reported out usually by the governor to the public.
For the full next day.
For the full next day.
People do go in and out of shelters all the time, but the official number is that count at the night.
So on the, just to let you know about some upcoming, again, Michael had talked about the state DSS disaster plan that would be coming out on or before July 1st with the revised content around aging and adult services, child welfare, CSFP, and DSNAP. Another area we wanted to kind of share and keep you informed about are training opportunities and forums and events that are hosted through North Carolina Emergency Management. There is one on July 17th. We provided the link for you to register. We'll also send an agenda to give you more information about what is going to occur on the 17th. But just some general topics include telemedicine during shelter operations, which many are interested in, response to civil unrest events, NC Sparta updates, Hurricane Matthew and Hurricane Florence updates. So it's a lot of information. There are a lot of partners that will be coming to that, and we would welcome our county departments of social services as well.
And in closing out, I do want to let folks know that in addition to reviewing the plan, like the child welfare and the adult services plans with DSNAP, one of the things that actually came to us early this week on Monday was an opportunity to comment on the hurricane disaster plan for the state of North Carolina's emergency management. And so I'm actually working with a small number of counties, five different directors, and I'm actually going to be sending sort of those directors the language that speaks to sort of who has the responsibility of running shelters. And that's a big question. And Melanie will laugh because she always knows that it's like NXB part 8, page 4, like whatever it is, like she knows exactly where to find that language. And we actually have an opportunity to comment on that language to make it more sort of general in scope that would give space for county departments of social services to really have conversations with their local emergency management and their county manager to really talk about how to broaden the scope of county level support in managing shelter. And so we actually have we have about a month's worth of time to comment and get that information back. And so I'm really appreciative of those five directors who have, without reservation, accepted every invitation for a conference call to comment on these plans. And I think that we would be remiss without being able to use the association's voice to add value to that piece on shelter management and hurricanes. So thanks, shout out to those five. And I wish I could remember exactly who they were right now, but I'm sure you all will find out shortly. Any other questions before we close?
There is a comment that came through and it says, yes, there is a question that asks, is someone in the household is required by law to register with a state or local government agency, and they received this form at the Red Cross shelter training last week.
Okay.
So there is something that
happened. Good. Thank
you.
Can you ask any further questions about it?
And what is the,
once they check yes.
Yeah. And I think the follow-up that we need to do is to really work with the Red Cross to understand what's the impact of answering yes to that question
to right.
the person's ability to get into the shelter.
Exactly.
Let's see, one more came in. It's a very long one. Hold on 1 second. We use the SOG blog reference sex offender in shelters during Hurricane Florence as a guide for addressing our sex offenders who registered at our shelters. It is most helpful and I recommend all review it. It helped us know, especially next time, how to handle the screening, when to accept them into a shelter, but monitored, when to have them transported to a holding cell by law enforcement, all based on the status of storm conditions and the time safety. We ended up connecting with our local law enforcement to work on agreed upon procedures as advised per the SOG blog and our attorney.
Thank you for the comment.
Thank you. We'll dig that up and review it and probably add it to our sort of information that you can use to provoke conversation locally.
That's a great resource.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you. Next on our agenda is the LGBTQ policy update. So I want to give you just a brief update on that. So as you all know, yesterday we issued the Dear County Director letter 02-19, LGBTQ identified children and youth. And we've heard from a lot of counties and pursued this change because we needed to update our policy. Our last policy was written in 2007, which is more than 12 years ago. And we all know the landscape has changed. In that spirit, we are committed to in working inclusively for all our citizens of North Carolina. We recognize this is a very, very important policy and we need and we want to get this right. After receiving some feedback last week and this week, we realized that we may have disseminated this policy a bit early. And it would benefit from additional input from a broader set of partners and stakeholders across the state. So we are going to allow for that additional time for input prior to the policy being implemented. And so this policy change will not take effect on July 1. We apologize for any confusion and look forward to working with you on this policy and its implementation, and look forward to hearing from you your feedback. You'll be receiving a written communication today with this information, but we just wanted you to have that so that you know there's a pause on this. And it's critically important policy, and we're going to take that input and take that time to incorporate anything we need to look at. So just put that on pause for now. So since we do not have that presentation today, I've asked Richard Stiganga to come in and give you a brief update on the work number.
Or David. I'm sorry.
I thought it was Richard. It's David Locklear, and evidently Richard's on his way. So David was going to give this update last week at the Economic Benefits, Economic Services Committee until he got struck down with strep. And so he missed.
I'm not contagious.
He's not. That's what everybody in this room is moving away from him at the table. So I think it's important for you all to get this update and to know that we are still working on the next contract very diligently. But so, David, I'll let you update folks.
Good morning, everybody. Real quickly.
You remind folks what this contract is.
This is Equifax for the work number. Equifax is the big company. The work number is a subsidiary of Equifax. So Richard is going to pop in any minute. He's going to talk a little bit more about the contract.
You hope.
But, but what I wanted to do real quickly is talk about usage. You know, we have actually seen an increase in the usage in the cost, and I'm sure you've seen in the county. And that's the piece Richard's going to talk about. But what I want to talk about real quickly is why, perhaps a couple of reasons why you're seeing increases in the usage for the work number. And the first reason I want to talk about is a good reason. Equifax has increased the number of employers that contract with them to handle their payroll in essence. And while this is a good thing because it helps with your workload, and it also helps with providing more timely, accurate benefits to the citizens that we serve. Currently, and I have, this is based on conversation with Equifax, they have not officially given this to me in writing, is currently they have approximately about 25,000 employers in their database. They are in the process of, I think the right word is acquiring, two paycheck companies.
Okay.
And these are companies that handle payroll for employers. I do not know who those two paycheck companies are, but Equifax has indicated by the end of this
calendar
year that they will move from 25,000 employers to 100,000 employers. Okay, so that's massive. So that means even a larger number of hits that you're going to be seeing from the work number, which means a greater cost.
So David, if you could pause right
sure.
there. So we have a lot of new directors who may not understand how that hit equates to their budget.
Okay, so your staff have access to Equifax to the work number database. So when there's a client that's applying for FNS or Medicaid, I think
First.
Child support uses the work number, Work First, and also SA uses the work number. So if they're doing an application or recertification and someone is employed and that person doesn't have their, and I'm speaking and I'm looking at Carolyn because I have to be careful, it's a little different with Medicaid.
Yeah.
If a person comes in, they don't have their paychecks or verification of their income, then typically the next step is your worker's going to utilize the work number. They
yeah.
sign into the Equifax portal. They enter the information to request information. If Equifax is the holder of that employer's data, then they're going to get a hit back based on the request that the worker makes. Okay. Now, the second part is that.
Well, and if
a little
once,
more?
Yeah, once the hit happens, it shows up in a county charge of how much per hit?
Well, so you're getting way in the weeds
okay.
contract. So
okay.
What? Well, I will.
It equates to a hit. The hit equates to a charge,
right.
And the charge is 100% county fund.
Right.
That's enough.
And yeah,
it
and
is,
Richard's
but,
gonna talk about. Richard will talk about a little bit more the contract of how the counties are billed. because it gets
It does. Routine. You're right. It does. And this is Carol. I'm with Medicaid and Medicaid. Also remember that that means if I get a hit there and I can verify it there, I don't have to send out wage forms. I don't have to do those other things that also cost money.
That's right.
If I can get electronic.
Just want new directors to understand the increase in employers, the increase in hit means an increase to your budget.
Yeah. And so what happens, we get a report from Equifax monthly that we reconcile, where we pull out, we break it down by county, the number of billable hits. Now you may, workers may request 25 inquiries, but out of those 25, Equifax is the holder of only 10 of those employers. So in essence, you would get billed for those 10 hits, not the 25 inquiries. Does that make sense? But we also know and believe that counties are getting charged for hits that they shouldn't be charged as a result of behavior of your staff. Mm-hmm. And so I want to go into that a little bit if I can.
So David, just to clarify that point, they should be charged for those hits because that is a billable hit. They should not be making the hit to not get themselves charged.
Right. In some cases, yes.
Okay.
So that's where I wanted to go, is that what we have found that when you go into Equifax to the portal, there's several options. You can select history for the past 3 months, 6 months, 1 year, or 3 years. Now, in most of our programs, unless you're an investigator and you're doing an investigation that takes you back 1 or 3 years, workers should not, in any case, unless it's an investigation that I can think of, should not be requesting six months or 1 year, and definitely not 3 years. We're seeing a lot, or if it's a hearing, we're seeing a lot of requests for wages back up to 3 years. So you're getting billed. You're getting if there's hits. You're getting billed for all of those hits for all of those employers that workers are requesting. Now, what I can't do today, what we've asked Equifax, actually just this week we've asked again, is we are asking them to provide us a report that is broken down by county, by worker, by hit request, or by request, whether it's the 1, 3 months, 6 months, 3 year, 1 year. Because I think that's information that you as the county director, you need to be aware of what, in fact, staff are requesting, which could be impacting your budget along with the additional employers. The additional employers we like, that's a good thing.
It takes other work off
it
of
takes, it. Yeah, it's taking a lot of work from in other areas, but what we want to stop is those unnecessary hits. We did send out a Deer County Director letter, I believe, and I didn't have the chance to pull it. I think last year in regards to what is a correct hit, and so we're really saying if you don't need the data, you shouldn't be making those requests because you are getting billed for any request you make that returns data from an employer. So Richard, one other area I wanted to mention, we are working with Equifax and NCFAS, I'm not going to go into a lot of detail here because there's a lot of outstanding things going on with this. We are working with NCFAS to do an integration with the work number, which would prevent counties from you having to log into a separate portal to request the data. The rules in NCFAS would trigger automatically those requests to Equifax, and we believe and our hope is that will eliminate some of the unnecessary hits that you perhaps are seeing. All right. Okay,
so there is on the budget financial side of things, what we're seeing is a significant uptick in the number of billable hits. So this is going to have an impact on you two different points in time. The first is your budget to close out the current fiscal year, and but more of an impact will be next year's budget. So we sent out a budget estimate, as you all know, and we based that estimate on the numbers available to us at that point in time for you to build your budget for the current year. Well, those numbers have increased pretty significantly since we did that and sent those out. Billable hits has gone up 81% in counties statewide, 81% since we generated the numbers based on the first 6 months of the fiscal year, current fiscal year, and where we are in the final 3 months of this fiscal year. So that's a pretty spectacular increase. Like, example, the average for the first quarter was a statewide was 103,000 average monthly billable hits for the first quarter of the current fiscal year. For the final quarter of the current fiscal year, the average monthly hit is 188,000. So going up from 104 to 188, that's that 81% increase. I think, as David already explained, part of that is just the nature of them adding more employers in the system. Part of it is the usage of the county worker in driving those hits. So to close out the current fiscal year, it may not be a very large impact on your budget as we trended the numbers out and the payment and billable cycle. So we pay Equifax and then we reach to you to reimburse us for the county share. It's going to increase your cost to close out the year. However, you're really going to see that next fiscal year. That's where you're really going to experience that 81% as that billing cycle matures and you feel that hitting you directly in what we charge you. So you're going to need to look. We'll provide you some additional data, county individually. You're going to need to look at your budget for next year. The good news is hopefully you'll have some ability to adjust that since we haven't started the year yet. But that is the heads up on that trend right now. So we really need to drill down on what that hit behavior like is at the county level. As David mentioned, we're reaching to the vendor to get more data to analyze and reach to individual counties on what we're seeing there.
So Susan, one of the things I think would be helpful and maybe with Carolyn and the other programs is doing a webinar around the work number and actually going through the system with counties. If counties feel that would be helpful in regards to the usage. And one of the other things I didn't mention is that we're also seeing, for whatever reason, you have workers that are going in multiple times in the same day for the same client, for the same employer, requesting the information multiple times. Now, maybe they think they didn't do it the first time, but those are some of the other things that we are seeing in regards to the usage. And one last thing is I failed to mention that Equifax, because as you start planning for your budget for next year, Equifax has anticipated that by the end of 2020, next year.
Thank you.
All right. Equifax.
He was reacting to the horror on my face that budgets are done.
And I knew that, but I was thinking I 2021.
I just wanted you to clarify. Okay. I knew you knew it.
Equifax is projecting that by the end of 2020, they will have 250,000 employers in their database. So,
and it's good if we can finish up the NCFAS integration.
Right.
But it's still a cost that has to
be.
Yeah. So, David, you raise a great point, and so having recently exited a county, I know my county friends out there know that we can train workers right now and do that webinar for the ones we have, but 3 months from now, we're going to have a different group of eligibility, of income eligibility staff.
And we did, we have sent out just recently, we did send out training from Equifax. So you guys have training that has was produced Equifax already that you can be used over and over for those new staff.
Yeah, so I was going to a different place.
I'm sorry.
I'm ready to put you on the screen on a webinar and taping it.
Recording it.
And recording it so that that is available.
Yeah.
Because I think we'll get feedback from counties that they would like that webinar. But if we record it, then that gives the option for that.
So, and I think, and that's great. We're more than willing to do that. But again, I think there has to be, when you drill down directors with your administrators and supervisors, there has to be some level of monitoring, accountability, and hopefully, again, based on the reports that we're requesting from Equifax, they're not been very forthcoming with those right now, but we are pushing. I think having specific information or specific worker will help you more better monitor and really analyze and pinpoint where you have those issues. I don't think it's, well, I know it's not everywhere in every body, but there's some folks that may need some extra help and understand how to properly navigate Equifax.
Okay.
Any questions?
Are there any questions?
Yes.
No!
First one is the time frame for a request listed anywhere, i.e., when would you use 3 month match, 6 month, 1 year, 3 year?
Well, that's based on the policy, based on the requirement of the policy. Mm-hmm. I mean, for FNS, you're looking at, if you're doing an application, you're looking at the base period. So you would be, it would be the month prior to the month of application.
Which is also the base period for Medicaid, but you also have retro. So it could be up to three months. So that would be situations where you would need prior months.
So again, it would be no different
more
than if you had, if you're requesting wages from the client, what month do you need? That's what you should be requesting.
And the next two are about Medicaid. So during our, let's go to the first one. Can you address the work number and Medicaid? We've been told we have to run the work number on all Medicaid applications and reviews, even if the client does not report income or wages. This has been why our hits have increased.
If there's no wages.
Okay. And we do have, you only get charged if there is a hit. So if they're not working, but requirements from the federal regulations that we must do all electronic matches on individuals who apply for Medicaid or during redetermination. So we can't ask them for information, we have to do the hits. If you have a hit, then that's a problem because that lets us know, hey, we don't have the right information, and then we have to.
It's important for counties to understand that you can run it on somebody who says they have no income. Yeah. And if they don't, you don't get charged for running it. You only get charged for the hit.
Unless you're doing that 3 years, they have three wages back 3 years
ago. Well, that's right.
You're going to get charged for those. Only if there's a returned hit.
Right.
You're going to be charged.
And you have to also remember that for Medicaid, we have a state statute that requires us to do all these kinds of reports and looking for income and things. So we are have a few different requirements than some of the other programs.
Federal and state.
During our Medicaid eligibility audit, the auditor held the county responsible for an internal control error because our staff did not run the work number for a 66-year-old female with no recent work history, 3 years. Please share this message with them so that there's a consistent message for staff. As a director, I'm telling staff to limit use of the work number. Then the auditor cited an internal control error when it was not used for a 66 female with no recent work history. Please make sure you're sharing this. It causes confusion for staff.
Well, I think that goes to what we just said. You've got to run it for Medicaid folks. And there are a lot of 66-year-olds and 70-year-olds. I'm over 65, and I'm still working full-time. So we are required to run those for Medicaid, and there is no age cutoff for something like that.
So what Carolyn's saying is every Medicaid application, no matter the age, needs
recertification.
right, application recertification needs a, you need to run the work number check. So we can't clarify with policy.
Right.
Because, I mean, with John's team, because that is the requirement and that is what they're looking for.
Do you have to go back 3 years?
No.
Cindy said specifically 3 years in that, what you just read.
No, you
They're just saying, what you follow exactly what David said for Medicaid as well. You look at what time period you're required to verify for. So for applications, that's the month prior, unless there's retro requested.
And then it's 3 months.
And then for recertification, it's the month prior to when you do your recertification. So very seldom is it going to be 3 years, unless you have a hearing reversal that you've got to verify wages, or a reopen from an application or something that was improper. There are, that's very, very seldom that you would do, or program integrity, as David said, that would be program integrity workers.
And I will say, in those selections, in that dropdown, actually currently it says the request options are 3 months, 6 months, 1 year, 3 years, or all. Mm-hmm. Now, I will be a little ugly right now because we have been really, really ugly with Equifax. We pushed back and said, your options make no sense. Mm-hmm. If we don't need this data, why is it there? And the response has been different states need different things, and they will not program the system to be specific to one state because they work with states all across the country. So, again, that's where it comes in, where it's extremely important that workers are very aware and observant and selective of the right option. We are asking them to give us the 1 month option back. And so that's where Richard's going to help me with the contract piece, where, you know, that could also be adding to the cost. So we are having very, matter of fact, we have a meeting this week regarding the contract and are moving forward. We are, honestly, I feel like I talk to Equifax every week. I've talked to them 3 times just this week, and it's Wednesday. So we are having these conversations. You know, they are a for-profit company, and there's only so much you can get these folks to change when it comes to their system. So that helps. I mean, that's the best I can give it. But I think, again, if we can move away from those 1 year, 3 year, 6 year requests, I think there's just a lot of that happening.
And duplicate requests.
And
if an FNS worker has requested something through Equifax, through Talks, or the work number, and a Medicaid worker is doing a recertification the next week, they can use the same thing that the FNS worker did. They do not have to do it again. So, you know, but those 3 years, even a 1 year, would be very rarely used, even in Medicaid.
Comment, definitely yes to a work number webinar. Then when I select 3 months, it still pulls up previous employers. If I look at the old employers, does that charge the county?
If there's a hit.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You get charged for any employer hit there for that time frame selected.
Since we're required to run the work number, why isn't there any form of reimbursement?
I mean, you are, for FNS, it's the normal 50-50 reimbursement. I can't speak to the other program. Should be no different than any other administrative costs for.
Didn't someone say that was 100% county cost?
Well, it's billed to the county, 100%, or taken from their EFT, right?
County pays 50%. It's the 50% share.
Mm-hmm.
There's the federal, and then there's the county. There's not a state.
Well, so then the question would be, is it 75% share on Medicaid? It's just 50?
I believe I have to look at the details.
We're going to get you some more information about that.
It is specific to the program.
Right.
Now that I think about it, yes.
Okay.
The last one, OST has told us only to run work number on work eligible individuals. What do you consider work eligible?
Well, I don't know what program that's for. For Medicaid, it's, you don't, we don't know how to determine who's work eligible. So again, you have to run it on everyone. You only get charged if there is a hit. So if someone has no work history and doesn't have anything in there, you won't get a hit and you won't get charged. So I'm not sure what work eligible, but we'll check and make
sure. It could be work first, work eligible. I don't know, but if that's the case, that shouldn't be. I mean, again, it's based on the program, the verification that's needed for that specific application. Now, I didn't really want to go into specific program stuff, but I will say this, where I understand when Medicaid requires the electronic verification, FNS does not. So listen, if a customer comes in and they've got the check stubs you need, you shouldn't be running work number if it's just FNS. You've already got the verification. There's nothing that requires you for work first, FNS, I would
child
say probably
support.
SA, child support, you have verification. So make sure staff aren't just automatically running the work number
as part of the whole,
as just part of their process. If they've got verification, client says they got it in the car, let them go get it. I mean, you know, this work number should be used as I don't want to say as a last resort, but I would say if somebody doesn't have it on the day of application, use the work number. But if they've got it, use the hard copy that you have.
Let's follow up on that work eligible from another person. We were told by OST that work eligible for Medicaid meant 16 and older.
Okay.
That makes sense. Okay.
We've got more.
Oh, okay.
For the county share, should we not have some type of formula that shows the number of Medicaid cases versus the number of FNS cases? And the look at percentages that will be applied to county costs.
We don't get that kind of level.
No, we get a breakdown by program. Richard would have to address how the budget's done.
Yeah. And so we get a report from Equifax, and we break it down by child support, food stamps, Medicaid, work first, and per hit. And then each county is charged the county share for each one of those programs as identified per county in that report.
And and then that gets shared with counties, or it just gets drafted?
There is a report out there. I have to look at the detail on that report.
So when we get you these other questions,
can certainly share if we're not sharing them.
Right.
And I would... Just back to the webinar, I would suggest that the webinar, we make the fiscal part, the budgeting part of that webinar.
Yes. So you're face too, Richard.
Can you hear me, Richard? I just volunteered you. You would be part of the webinar.
Sure.
To talk about the budget.
Sure.
Okay. Are we done, Andy?
No, we're not.
Opened a can of worms.
I knew this.
Well, it's okay.
It's needed.
Are counties charged per employer returns or per person that is entered?
Employers returns.
Employers.
Returns. Called a hit.
A hit.
Yeah.
Okay.
There's billable hits. Billable hits are what you're charged for.
If the answer for Medicaid is it 16 and older for everyone in the household?
It is everyone who has applied for Medicaid or Health Choice. We'll get that out to you along with these other questions, but I'm just trying to figure out where the 16 came from.
We were told we had to run work number even if OVS showed wages. And if work number pulled back info, that we should use the work number. Is this correct? I'm confused because you just said if they have check stubs, use them, but you also run work number on everyone who is work eligible.
When I said check stubs, I was only speaking for FNS and work first. It's a little different than Medicaid, but I mean, OVS is not verification of wages. It's just a lead that shows that this person has wages. We don't use what's in OVS as the verification. You have to verify the actual wages.
And we can't.
Because OVS is by quarters, is it not?
It's by quarter. Mm-hmm. It's usually a couple quarters behind. Mm-hmm. And the work number is current wages.
Right.
So that would always be the primary. If we can't get anything else, we can use the wage match, but that should be after we've looked at the work number or anything else. Yeah.
That's more research. Mm-hmm.
We were told in the past to use ESC for Medicaid research and applications if ESC provides representative information. Should we run work number prior to running OVS?
We should do the work number and see if there's any current wages or wages in the base period that you're working on your research for, and we can use the ESC sort of as a last resort. That is not necessarily representative. It's 6 months old or older. And
work number's real time.
The work number's real time. It's current. In most cases, if you're not looking at this month, you can get their last pay period. So we looked at the base period month, just like FNS or Work First or any others.
And that's all.
Okay. Well, so obviously we hit on some things that we need to follow up on. So we'll plan to get a document out.
So just following up on the prior question, yes, on the state website, we do post county-specific by program hits going back to 2016.
But we will send you the link.
So that is in the budget section. Just go to the DSS, the division website, info for counties. Go to the budget section, and there's something called the work number, and that's where you'll find it.
But we'll send you the link. Great. Thank you, Richard. Okay, let's move on to Joyce Massey-Smith and Aging and Adult Services update.
Great. Good morning, everybody. Thank you for giving us some time, Susan, to talk about a few things. I'm very excited to share that we have a new adult services section chief taking my place, Carrie Perez. Many of you know Carrie from her work in counties and with us as an adult programs representative. So we are getting fully staffed. We also have a new trainer, Denise Leek, and we're also happy to announce a new program coordinator in the APS world, Laura Garganis. So we are fully staffed and tickled to death about that. We are about to release our training calendar for the year and hoping that we will reach parts of the state that have not been covered and will provide that. We usually release it right after the budget comes out, so hopefully that will be soon. Wanted to give you an update on the work around Ryland's Law and our work with the Center for Supportive Families. We did have an internal envisioning session back in April that included, I think, six or seven folks from directors as well as program managers and staff from DSSs and our staff to talk about sort of where we think we need to go with adult protective services and guardianship. And the next step in that is to bring in a larger group, broader group of stakeholders that have an interest in this work and kind of develop a vision for where we want to go. And I will share, we've sent it out several times. If you don't have it, haven't seen it, we are planning to adopt the Administration for Community Living voluntary APS standards. And as some of you may not know, as new directors, we don't have federal standards or resources or guidelines for adult protective services or guardianship. And so these voluntary standards, we hope, will help us align with what the Administration for Community Living will eventually have in place and that we can secure funding as it becomes available. So Laura Garganis, who we've just hired, will have some responsibility there, and we'll be working forward on that. The other piece of what that group talked about was multidisciplinary teams. And many of you have those for adult protective services and guardianship. And we are really encouraging counties to consider that. The adult programs representatives will be working with you on that. And we also have some training. It'll only be able to involve six or seven counties. Many of you have seen that come out from the School of Government, but we we'll continue that work to make sure that you have the resources and information to be able to put together an MDT. Eventually, we would like to see when this stakeholder group comes together is a path forward for what we think we need to do about adult protective services in North Carolina. So we will be getting, as soon as we hear from CSF on those next dates, we will be sharing that information. The other thing we wanted to share with you is that we are about to hopefully get approval for our state aging plan. It's a four-year plan that we develop to address all the issues under sort of the purview of our division, as well as our relationship and work with other divisions, Medicaid, public health. We're excited to be engaging with the NC Care 360, but sort of the high-level priorities of that plan are around protection of vulnerable adults, making sure that families and communities have access to information about resources that folks need, making sure that underrepresented members of our state, communities in our state are engaged and have access to services. You know, sometimes that's rural areas, low-income folks, the LGBTQ community, people, minorities. And so we're really, really trying to focus on that and make sure that we're reaching those folks. Another big piece of our plan is around the opioid crisis, which is a priority for the governor and the department, and certainly one for us. And we will be conducting our third symposium this fall, at November 1st, at the McKinnon Center. It's free training. It's for online staff and managers who are working with folks to try to understand and get them to the right resources around opioid misuse. And so look for more to come about that. And so, as you know, we are quickly facing the end of a budget year, and there are a few things I want to bring to your attention that will affect your budget, and we don't have, you know, full answers on all this right now, but want to share with you that the special assistance temporary payments to facilities, that $34 payment that is 50% state, 50% county, will end June 30th if there's not a continuing resolution that will say that that's done, because it's non-recurring. There has to be some special action to make that happen. And we are working with our budget folks, as well as fiscal research over the General Assembly, to see what can be done about that. And I will say that we have continued to be under budget on that spending. So I don't know that, you know, in terms of impact on county budgets, that's going to be a big issue, but I think we're going to be hearing from facilities. I've let my staff know to let me know when, you know, because facilities are going to wonder what's going to happen come July 1. And so that we're as close on that, we're bird dogging that to make sure that we're in, know what we need to do come July 1. The other piece of the SA budget is the personal needs allowance increase. That there are two figures. The House, I believe, proposed $70, and the Senate proposed $58.
Yeah.
And if you recall, we've not seen an increase in the personal needs allowance, I believe, since 2003. And for those of you new or are not familiar with the special assistance program, that personal needs allowance is what that individual receives out of their SA payment and Social Security payment that goes to the facility for their own personal needs that are not covered. Some of those include, you know, getting haircuts, getting their hair done, extras that they, you know, copays. A lot of folks use that for their copays and there's nothing left. And so we will, you know, that's, again, 50% state, 50% county money, so we'll be watching that. The current bill that we're looking at that the Senate has is not to go into effect until October 1. So we've already been in contact with NCFAS and knowing what we can do to be ready to do that October 1. And I think it will not be a big deal for us in terms of it'll just be that monetary change. And again, The trending for SA is down. Probably 8 or 10 years ago, we had probably close to 30,000 recipients, and we're down to about 19, 20 now. And that's because the rates have not changed. And this legislation around the PNA requires the rates to stay the same. So we've had to do some complicated math, I would say, to figure out how to make that happen without increasing the rate. Because special assistance is an optional state supplement with the Social Security Administration, we also have to have their approval. And so we have reached out to those folks and sent them the legislation. They are looking at it, and we will, act accordingly. If the General Assembly passes a rate increase or a temporary payment that the Social Security has concern with, we will revisit that and can deal with that later. So just wanted to make you aware of that, and that you may be getting calls from families or facilities, particularly about those temporary payments. And in the governor's budget, there was close to $1 million for out of the SSBG plan for adult protective services staff at county level. And right now, the Senate, I think, kind of cut that in half. So we don't know until we pass the budget what that will be, but that will go directly into, we think, your SSBG pot, and there shouldn't be any separate coding that goes along with it because it's such a small amount of money, but the General Assembly will let us know how we need to manage that. But it will not require you to hire new staff. It will just pay for your current APS staff and hopefully put a little relief on those county dollars. And again, the Home and Community Care Block Grant, there was a recommendation, a bill in the House that would increase that by about $4.7 million. The Senate had it at just that restoration of a little over $900,000. And of course, we know that you at the county level, working with those Home and Community Care Block Grant service providers, know that there are long waiting lists. And so this is an important resource for you, particularly for adult protective services clients. But we'll see what comes out in the final legislation. I'm to the end of mine. That was quick. Andy, any questions?
No.
All right. Thanks, everybody. Thanks, Joy.
Yeah.
All right, we'll move on and do a child welfare update. Okay. Lisa Colley.
Good morning, y'all. I've got some good news and some updates, and hopefully I won't keep you too long. I just want to reiterate a lot of what I covered at the Children's Services Committee with the Directors Association, but I know everyone doesn't attend, so I want to make sure they all have this information. We submitted to the governor's office last week the Child and Family Services Plan, and that is Child Welfare's 5-year strategic plan. It goes to the Administrative Office of Children and Families, to the Children's Bureau, so that they know what we intend to do with the next 5 years. North Carolina has always had a plan, but there are two things that really changed with this plan. One is the program instructions from the federal government were very specific around this is the plan, and really good guidance on how to do the plan and how to take into account some of the things that we know will change over the next 5 years, like the implementation of the Family First Prevention Services Act. And the other thing is really that there was a need for child welfare reform, as we know from Rollins Law. So we incorporated this information into our plan and developed our 5-year plan. I'm going to go over, Andy, if you switch to the next slide, I'm going to come back to the goals, but talk a little bit about how we developed the Child and Family Services Plan. The plan is to be done and was done in alignment with the program improvement plan. So all of the good things that came out of our program improvement plan, like our foundational court work, like the Family Advisory Council, those strategies are folded into the plan. And it is aligned with what we have achieved through the program improvement plan. The APSR, which is the progress and services report, is the yearly update to the CFSR. So we had to complete an APSR to close out our last strategic plan that we finished. And so what I really like about the strategic planning process for child welfare is the Child and Family Services Plan, you do it for 5 years, you do a great plan, you do an overview with metrics, and you are allowed to update it every year with your APSR. So we took this very seriously. It requires a holistic assessment of all child welfare programs and funding, and there's a lot of written information that goes with the CFSP. And then you do joint planning, which includes stake and includes your stakeholders. So we had a very large joint planning session held in May. The tri-chairs attended, and we had a lot of private agencies, a lot of stakeholders, and our family advisory partners at the table. And I will say it was about 40 people. And we talked through, in general, what we were doing well, achieving the outcomes of safety, firmness, and well-being, and where we needed to go, and had a real meeting. And what I've said about that meeting is it was a little bit anxiety-provoking because there were no dogs and ponies present. We didn't plan an agenda. We didn't show them how well we're doing or what we're concerned about. We just talked through with ACS facilitating and with our stakeholders engaging in the discussion where we needed to go with the state in the next 5 years. So that was a real foundation for our plan. The good thing was, I think that we didn't learn anything. I think the tri-chairs would agree with me. We didn't learn anything we already didn't know. But some of the things, but we did learn what was most important to our stakeholders. And so that joint planning was folded into the CFSP. The CFSP was developed with the children's services tri-chairs. We had almost weekly, sometimes twice a week, conference calls. The Center for Supportive Families facilitated so that we agreed on what our strategic goals were. So, and we're very proud of what, I think we're very proud of the strategic goals that we've selected. And we believe that we have selected the things that matter, the things we can actually do, and the things that will make a difference in the next 5 years. So I'm going to go back to my last slide, and I'm going to talk through with a little bit about where the plan is and what the strategic priorities are. Right now, the plan is with the governor's office. Once the plan gets through the governor's office, there may be edits, and it has to go to ACF at the end of the month, by the 30th. And so once it's sent, it will go back to the tri-chairs. And it can be disseminated in draft form, but the plan is not final until ACF says you are done and your plan is good. And usually that negotiation takes a couple of months. ACF has been a part of our plan and they've seen our draft, so we hope it won't take long because we're excited about this and want to get it out before you, directors. Probably the first time you're going to see a lot of information about the plan will be at the Social Services Institute, where Heather Steens and I will present the plan and hope that we have a lot of directors that attend our Social Services Institute session. So that's where we are. Now, I'm going to walk you through what our five strategic priorities are and tell you a little bit around what's in each category. Now, remember, I'm not going to go into metrics. I'm not going to go into strategies, but we've outlined everything that we have in a way that we can measure it, and we have some strategies, but we're allowed to add strategies without ACF approval, so we don't have every strategy wrapped up. And we have 5 years to do this. So we have a goal related to safety. I think this is when we were, this, of course, is basic. How do we assess safety? And also, how do we better provide a prevention network, or DSS have access to a prevention network across North Carolina? So the safety goal has strategies related to better assessment of safety. Some of that includes moving into a practice model in the next couple of years, validating the risk assessment tools. But it also has strategies related to how do we make sure that DSSs understand the scope of safety, of prevention programs, primary prevention programs across the state, and how do we organize that in a way that the DSS has access to it. Missed anything there. The next, of course, and you see our three outcomes should always be our priorities for any type of strategic planning. Permanency, we have strategies related to decreasing the number of days children spend in foster care, creating stable placements, and also ensuring that any youth that exit the foster care system as an adult exit successfully. So that strategy has a lot there. Well-being is a very interesting one because we took a real challenge in one of our strategies, and that is that we are going to better define what our in-home services consist of and what are expectations there. That will be one of the expectations, one of the things we have to do with Family First, but that's in there. Also making sure that all children have wellness checks, at least one wellness check a year. And let me see if I forgot anything in wellness. There may be something else there, but that's the gist of it. Continuous quality improvement, really developing in North Carolina what is in child welfare our model for continuous quality improvement. And you know, one of the things that if I ask someone in the counties, what does child welfare do for CQI, their answer is the same as if I ask somebody that works for the state, that we all consistently understand what that is and we know how to use it to make improvements in child welfare. The other is that we address our data quality, regardless of where we go, you know, regardless of whether we're in NCFAS or not in NCFAS, we still have data that we have to report to the feds, and we do a lot of work around trying to get the data right, but this allows for strategies to where we really focus on how do we make sure that we input data correctly and we get reports that are correct in an organized way. And then the last goal is that North Carolina would have a comprehensive statewide case management system that captured federally and state required data and increased the user efficiencies for users. And I think that's where your electronic case management system comes in. ACF funds has provided funding for case management system, and this has to be a part of our plan. And I think when you look at agreement, we can all agree that we need those three things. We need a statewide system, we need something that captures our data, and it needs to be efficient for you, or increase efficiencies for users. The last is very important for the success of child welfare, and that's that we focus on the workforce. So in this strategy, we have a workload study that really looks at the burden of work on our staff and what's reasonable as far as caseloads. The other is development of a comprehensive staff development program where we retool our training, make sure we provide coaching and all types of support so we reduce we increase the retention of workers. And then the last is implementing a stipend child welfare education training program, both for new recruits out of universities and also existing staff. I think we've done it. We've kept a lot of the good work we did with the Child Welfare Training Collaborative with both the directors. The directors doing their good work around finding field placements and the universities still training, but we need to make sure that those folks that we're training both in the universities enter the workforce and stay, and that we provide coaching and support for them once they're there. So number six strategies is really not on there because you don't really say to ACF, we're going to look at how we fund our funding, but just critical to achieving these five priorities is that we look at how we align funding to achieve our goals. And for example, when you really look at the contracts that we do, how do we use those contracts to improve outcomes? How do we better align our funding to make the changes we want to make? And so some of this revolves around, we have a contract or an MOU with Annie Casey to provide a consultant to help us look at how do we maximize our 4E. You know, Family First causes us to look at 4E a little bit differently, but there's still things that we know we need to do to maximize 4E. And then there will be changes too with Family First, and some of our prevention funding. We will be able to use 4E for that, which would open up other funding for other prevention type activities. So when you have this much change over a course of 5 years, you have to make sure that you look at both at your outcomes, which we have our safety, permanency, and well-being, your continuous quality improvement, the people that do the work, and how you pay for it. So we think our plan does all of that. And I guess I will add next steps, or we figure out who do we need at the table in each of these categories to make it work. And I will think the tri-chairs will join me in saying we took a break after many weekends of work and getting this plan ready. And so knowing that we don't have to have a real plan for who works on this before, you know, the fall, we're going to take some time and really think about what's the team and structure that will make it work, and do some, you know, have some face-to-face meetings while we're at Social Services Institute, hear back from our staff when we present the plan, and really make sure that as we set up a team and structure with work groups, that they're chartered, that there's understood expectations around who decides what and how they interface, so that when we set it up, the work groups are successful. Okay, any questions? Because that's a whole lot of talking for me. All right. Child welfare update. The closeout of the PIP meant we are in the modified manual. So it was understood counties were going to begin using the modified manual in the middle of May. The modified manual is online. However, there's a lot of information online. So what's happening at the state between now and the end of the month is we are removing any obsolete information that's online that's not consistent with the modified manual, and cleaning up the website and making sure the forms are right on the website. So when we get to the drop-dead date of July 1, what's left is the modified manual, the chapters that will be standalone chapters, and updated forms. I want to make sure you're aware on NCS Ready to Learn is a really great training around the Family First Prevention Services Act that Alicia Blackwell Pittman recorded, and I think it's a great both introduction and in detail information about what Family First will bring to North Carolina. The third thing is we've had some resignations and retirements of the children's program reps. And so some of you may have temporary CPRs assigned to your counties that know that we are hiring new CPRs, and that if you have any concerns or CPR questions for right now, Peter West has been hired as a local support team manager when Teresa Strom was promoted. And so you can contact Peter West about CPR concerns. We are getting ready to send out information about Triple P. We will be able to fund, and this is Triple P that's a part of the BOCA grant that the state received. Our hope is that we will fund up to 40 counties who are able to provide Triple P services through a facilitator that does Level 3. And if those of you that are not familiar with Level 3 Triple P, that's a lot of words right there. Level 3 Triple P is really designed for families where maltreatment has occurred, and so more about that will come next month. And I know Kristen O'Connor presented, and I think most counties are very interested in Triple P and wanted to let you know that's coming. Evan Friedel, who is our 4E coordinator, has webinars next week about 4E. And we are preparing for the annual 4E review. So there was a letter that went out week before last just saying get ready. You're asking counties to do their 100% review of all 4E cases, of all the foster care cases, so that we're ready for the annual review. This is probably the toughest review we have. So I'd ask that you go back and make sure you're familiar with the requirements in the review and that your staff is preparing.
No questions.
Y'all are good to me today.
Awesome. We haven't talked yet. Awesome. Right on time. So Carolyn is up next. She's going to give you a Medicaid transformation and a Medicaid update. And she has 22 minutes because this thing shuts down at 11 o'clock because many of us have an 11 o'clock meeting somewhere.
We all know. Good morning. It is still morning, right? Yes. I do have a quick staff update. I will tell you that we do have several positions posted, so we're recruiting policy consultants and a couple other ones. But I do have an announcement about the new eligibility policy manager, Sharon Moore. And I know she was with Durham County for about 20 years. She's been with Division of Social Services for like the last 14, I believe. And so she's over there in our Medicaid eligibility policy manager slot. We do have two consultants who are relatively new, just from the last few months, Shanna Patterson and Blake Gore. So some of you may get contacted by them if I don't.
Okay.
It came from Susan's old account. Those are a couple of staff updates. I wanted to talk a little bit about transformation. Today is June 19th. So, we have some things that are going to be happening very, very shortly. So the letters that are going out to all the current Medicaid and Health Choice beneficiaries who are going to be either mandatory or exempt are going to start going out June 28th. And they will be mailed over 8 days. So it's going to be approximately, I think it's around 40,000 or so each day. We have to get them out before pretty quickly because there are certain federal time frames that you have to meet by notifying people ahead of time for before you start up. Please ensure that your staff, and that means not necessarily just Medicaid workers, have looked at the transition notices, and I hope you know by now where the county playbook is located. It is on the DHB website under the counties tab, and under the picture there where you'll see a long bar that is the link to the county playbook. Specifically, make sure that you're looking at all those things that say enrollment packet. This was part of release two, and it has enrollment packet, mandatory notice, enrollment packet, exempt, and enrollment packet. So all of those that start with enrollment packet are the ones that are going to go out June 28th and the next 8 days. So that gives you an idea of what they're getting. You can see it. I will say the comparison chart is included there. Now, what the one that is posted is actually not the final. It still has the Medicaid, the plan card sort of as a placeholder, but we now have finalized, I believe, the approval of all those enhanced services or value-added services and incentives that the plans want to offer and have made those decisions. And so that will be replaced on the chart. And so the one that will go out will actually have those services listed that each plan provides in addition to the normal state plan Medicaid covered services. So you'll notice there are three notices. There's one that says mandatory. That means that all members in the household are mandatory. There's one that is exempt. It means all members in the household are exempt. And there is one that says mandatory and exempt combined because these are being sent by households. We're not sending them to individual people so that a household is not going to get six notices or whatever. So if there are members in the household that are mandatory and some who are exempt, they will get one notice and it's separated saying what each person has to do. So they will get one notice. We did start virtual office hours on Monday morning. There was a call at 9:30 and we had participation from a good number of counties. This was because and partially due to the release in NCFAST of the managed care screen. Again, those screens were not anything that the workers were going to have to handle or do anything with. It was just that they were going to be seeing that information with the release. We have had very, very few calls to those virtual office hours. I think on Monday we had one, and yesterday we had five. So we'll be getting some information out to you on whether or not continue. But again, when we ramp up for what's really going to happen June 28th and later, there will be something similar. So we'll be getting information out to you about what's going to happen once we get those notices out to beneficiaries. I do want to remind the directors there was a survey that was sent to you, I believe it was last Thursday, and it was about whether or not you wanted on-site assistance from the enrollment broker during open enrollment. We need to hear from everyone. As of last night, we had 87 counties who had responded and no one had said no. So we are leaving that survey open today, the final day. And there are 13 counties, and I'm sorry, I'm going to tell you who you are just as a reminder. And Sharnie sent out, we were emailing about midnight last night, so she sent a reminder to those counties as well. But we had Alamance, Alexander, Allegheny, Cabarrus, Cleveland, Craven, Currituck, Davidson, Gates, McDowell, Mitchell, Randolph, and Watauga are the ones that we did not see a response for. So please go in and respond to those questions in that survey today because we really need that in order to start finalizing what the support is going to look like And I think a few of these counties are actually in the first group, so we really need your response. And it's not that far until phase two starts, and so we really have to start working on what the support's going to look like for the phase two counties as well. So please respond to that survey. And if you're in one of those counties, you should have a reminder email from Sharnice. We are working also with the EB on their outreach events that are going to be happening around the counties that are in regions 2 and 4. And as soon as we have those finalized, we'll get them to you so that you will know about the events. I think that's about it as far as transformation. A couple things that are related but not. We do have several thousand cases that are on hold, because the worker has not accepted a decision, and they really need to be. They need to go in and accept those decisions and get those cases off hold. So supervisors, there was a fix sometime a couple months ago, I believe, where you now can see on your dashboard your workers' on hold decisions. So please try and get those cleaned up as quickly as possible, because there are some things that need to happen, and we've got to have those cases off the hold. We were working on a list, and so you may be hearing about it or getting a list either through NCFAST on Fast Help or the OST. We're trying to figure out when we get the list how we're going to get it out there. So really important that we need to get that address mailings that we have done. We've already done a good part of regions 1 and 3, I think, have been done. We're finished, of course, mailing those out for regions 2 and 4. Please make sure that when individuals report address changes to you, that you update as quickly as possible. We will be posting the results as soon as we start getting returned mail from regions 1, 3, 5, and 6. We'll be posting that, and we will let you know. It's on Fast Help right now, and so that you can go in and work that list. One of the things I wanted to bring up that was a little concerning, and I can't remember if I said this last month, but some of the returns said that the forwarding time had expired. So that means that it's been about a year, and so mail should have been coming back. And so that's a little concerning that we've got a good number that the forwarding time has expired, and so trying to figure out why we don't have those updated addresses. But please be diligent in getting those addresses updated. We all want at least as little returned mail as possible with all the mailings that are going to be going out. And it's not just Medicaid. Medicaid just has multiple ones now, but it's all the programs, mm-hmm. plus the service letters and those kinds of things all go out. So it's really important that we have the addresses correct. And I think that's
it. Do I have a question? Has North Carolina Medicaid determined when the counties will actually receive a complete copy of the welcome package that beneficiaries in regions 2 and 4 will receive starting June 28th?
And Susan has an update. We have, there's a meeting this morning, and we will get that out to you. However, the things are actually posted in the playbook.
Right. Yeah,
right. It's posted on the playbook, and I'm going to look. So the enrollment packet stuff is there. That's what they're going to get. And then additionally on the website, you can see the flyers and things like that that have been done.
But yeah, I think we recognize that in the playbook it's in pieces.
Mm-hmm. It's
in pieces. And I understand the request is for mm-hmm. the packet together so that they can show that to their staff and train their staff so that when folks start receiving that, mm-hmm. or they call on the phone and say it's on page 6 of what I got, that it will match up.
Right. So when you look
so
at those notes,
we're working on that.
It's being worked on, but it is all that you get in enrollment packet. That's why I said it's enrollment packet. All those 5 things say enrollment packet notice, enrollment packet fact sheet. That is what's being sent out June 28th, and it's all there together, identified. Now I have to print it out and all that kind of stuff. But remember, those notices, the pages won't always be consistent because of the number of people.
Right. So when somebody calls on the phone and says, on page 6, this says, mm-hmm. the county's got to know what's on page 6 that the member has.
Mm-hmm.
So we got it. Thank you for reminding us. It's on the top of our list.
No other questions.
Okay.
Right.
We finished on time, 10 minutes early. So I want to thank you for joining us today.
Hold on.
Uh-oh.
Ooh, I didn't talk fast enough.
Can counties receive an electronic copy of the welcome package? This will make it easier for counties to share within the agency.
Yes, Sharnice has already asked for that.
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh.
What? Oh, Sharnice. I put that down yesterday when you asked me for it.
She wanted to make sure everybody heard that. So, yeah.
Good for you. So thank you for joining us. Your questions and your input is valuable to us as we all together and as partners do this work. We have no call in July due to the Social Services Institute. So we're looking forward to seeing you all there. And our next call will be August 28th. So thanks and have a great Wednesday.
Yay.